محمد رسول الله، محمد رسول الله، أرجو رضاك يا أنت الرحيم، هبني عطاك يا أنت الكريم، منك العطاء يا أنت العظيم.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين وعلى من تبع هداهم إلى يوم الدين. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Dear viewers from the brothers and the sisters, as we have said, this is an episode regarding the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam's counseling. So now we have been talking about the evil eye. And the last thing that we talked about, that was a story from our Sheikh Muhammad Musa Nasr. Sheikh Muhammad, he told us that one day a man approached him and he said, my wife had given birth of a child. And alhamdulillah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blessed her as well, that she had a lot of milk. So what happens is when the women, they came to give congratulations to the wife of his, they had an evil eye. What happened is a big massive lump took place straight away. So the following day she was not able to feed and suckle the child. And that's why the man is coming to the sheikh. So he believes 100% that it is an evil eye. So the sheikh, he said to him, well, it could be an evil eye. Most likely it's an evil eye. But now to disinfect it, we need to do that. We have to ask these people, this woman who came, and I need to ask them to make ghusl, that is to make the wudu, to wash the inside of their clothes and dip it in the water in order to put that onto your wife. So he said, verily, sheikh, if I do that, war will be triggered. You know, these people will not be tolerating such a thing. So the sheikh, he said to him, okay, invite the same people. Then after that, do the following. Now when they come inside the house, an Islamic house, usually they will take off their shoes outside. Now take their shoes, because that shoes is mixed with the sweat of their bodies. Bring a bucket of water, dip all the shoes in the bucket of water, take it out, make it to dry. And if the woman comes out and they see the shoes are wet, you know, you could just say that, for example, children, you know, have done something, and you know, you could make an excuse without making a lie. So what he did, he invited the same woman, and the same woman came to congratulate again for the meal. And then he brought a bucket of water and he put all the shoes of those women into the bucket of water, and he took them out. And then after they left, took that bucket of water and he put it on his wife, and everything went back to normal by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This tells us, you know, subhanallah, it is beneficial. But all to do is just to depend and to be assured that what Allah and His Messenger tells you is a true fact. So this is the cure for the nadar. And also we said, there's a precautionary way of doing it. To protect yourself before the nadar takes place, before the evil eye. See, the evil eye is like a laser light coming from the eyes. It looks like a laser light. Something that would, you know, comes from the evil eye, when it, you know, when the shaitan is there as well, and it will hit the target and it will cause the harm by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to teach us some supplications to do in order to protect ourselves. So he used to, for example, protect Al-Hasan al-Husayn by saying, "U'idhukuma bi kalimatillahi tamma min kulli shaytanin wa hamma wa min kulli 'aynin lamma." I seek refuge in the perfect words of Allah, the Almighty, from every evil eye and from every devil. So min kulli shaytanin wa hamma wa min kulli 'aynin lamma. So from evil, every evil, and from every evil eye. And the way to do it, if you have children, you put your right hand on the head of your child, the left hand on the other child, and you do that for both. Then if you have more children, you bring another two, you do the same thing, put the right on the right and the left on the left on their heads, and you do the dua. This is as a protection. Not only that, you could say as well the following dua, for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam taught us, Bismillahi arqik min kulli shay'in yu'dhik. That is, in the name of Allah, I give you the incantation, the ruqya, from everything that harms you. Min sharri kulli nafsin aw ayni hasidin wallahu yushfik, bismillahi arqik. That is, from every evil soul and from every evil eye who envies. The evil eye is to envy. And that is, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give you the cure. Bismillah, in the name of Allah, I give you the ruqya. So this is the ruqya against the evil eye. Now the hadith talks about as well, which is al-Sha'bi from Buraida, is that there is no ruqya more beneficial than the ruqya which is against the evil eye and the bite or the sting of a poisonous animal. Now this narration, even though it is from a companion, it was narrated as well from the Prophet of Allah. And the one who had done that is Imran ibn Husayn. May Allah be pleased with him. He had said that this is from the Prophet of Allah. He said the same narration. So it is not just from a companion, it's from the Messenger of Allah. Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu narrates for us a story that took place with the Prophet wasallam. The Messenger of Allah was stung by a scorpion while he was praying. So when he finished from the prayer, he said, لَعَنَ اللَّهُ الْعَقْرَ. May Allah curse the scorpion. لَا تَدَعُ مُصَلِّيًا وَلَا غَيْرًا. It does not leave the person who prays or any other person alone. I mean, stings him or bites him. So what he did, he called for water and salt. And he started rubbing where the sting it was. He started rubbing and he was starting as well. He started reciting the following surah. قُلْ يَا أَيُّهَا الْكَافِرُونَ قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ الْفَلَقِ and قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ النَّاسِ. Again, قُلْ يَا أَيُّهَا الْكَافِرُونَ قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ الْفَلَقِ and قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ النَّاسِ. So here this is a ruqya from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam regarding a sting of a scorpion. Now, coming to our story, you remember that is Husayn ibn Abdul Rahman, he was this teacher, Sa'id ibn Jubayr, and he said, verily I was not in a prayer, but I was stung, and then I sought for ruqya because al-Sha'bi told us that Buraida, he said, the companion, there is no ruqya more beneficial than the ruqya against the evil eye or the sting or the bite of a poisonous animal. Then he said, that is Sa'id ibn Jubayr, قَدْ أَحْسَنَ مَنْ انْتَهَى إِلَى مَا قَدْ سَمِعْ. He has done well, the person who acted upon what he had learned, upon what he had heard. So you've done well, because you have heard this from a companion, and you acted upon it. You acted according to what you had heard, which is very good. And this is a praise from the teacher to the student, that the person acts according to the knowledge that he has got. He does not make himself and open for experiments. You know, you're not open for experiments. You have to do what Allah tells you. And you have to do what the Prophet ﷺ tells you. You have to stop from what Allah told you not to do. And you have to stop doing what the Prophet ﷺ prohibited you from doing. And this is what we call a sam'u wa ta'a, hear and obey. And you have to respond very quickly and swiftly, straight away, if you hear the command from Allah. إِنَّمَا كَانَ قَوْلَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. Verily, the saying of the believers, إِذَا دُعُوا إِلَى اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ, that if they are being called to Allah and His Messenger, أَيَّقُولُوا سَمِعْنَا وَأَطَعْنَا, that they say, we hear and we obey. We hear and obey. Not we hear and we disobey. قَدْ سَمِعْنَا وَأَطَعْنَا. And it is incumbent upon the Muslim to be stopping on the borders where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put the borders. He can't jump and he can't go over the borders. It's very important. And that is, we find the story of Bara ibn Azib radiallahu anhu. When the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he had taught him the dua before he goes to the bed. The dua, Allahumma inni sallamtu nafsi ilayk wa wajjahtu wajhi ilayk wa fawwadtu amri ilayk wa alja'tu dhahri ilayk raghbatan wa rahbatan ilayk. And that is the dua which says, O Allah, I put my affair into your hands. O Allah, I surrender myself to you. I seek protection from you. O Allah, I direct my face towards you. There is la manja wa la malja'a minka illa ilayk. There is no shelter, there is no salvation from you except to you. Raghbatan wa rahbatan ilayk, that is in hope and fear from you. And then he said, amantu bi kitabika alladhi anzalt wa bi nabiyyika alladhi arsalt. And he taught him to say as well, I believe in the book which you have revealed and the prophet which you have sent. Now, Al-Bara ibn Azib, upon hearing the words of the Prophet of Allah, who is the teacher, he started now to repeat behind the Prophet ﷺ in order to perfect the dua, the supplication. Because the Messenger of Allah said, if you die on the night that you have said these words, فَقَدْ مِتَّ عَلَى الْفِطْرَةِ. You have died upon fitrah. That means upon tawheed, monotheism. If it was the last word of yours, you say it and you die, after you sleep and you die on those words, you have died upon tawheed and monotheism. What a death to die. So he learnt these words and he kept now repeating them. When he arrived to the statement where it says, amantu bi kitabika alladhi anzalt, I believe in the book which you have revealed, wa bi nabiyyika alladhi arsalt, and with the prophet, he said, wa bi rasulik. Instead of wa bi nabiyyik, that is the prophet, wa bi rasulik, that is, I believe in your messenger which you have sent. Now, There is not much difference between an-Nabiy and a-Rasul. It's a very delicate sort of difference, as only the scholars would know it. But we know for a fact that when you say Rasul, it will include the Nabi, because every Rasul has to be a Nabi. Every messenger has to be a prophet. He can't be a messenger except if he's a prophet. So he did not change that much. So he said, وَأَمَنْتُ بِرَسُولِكَ الَّذِي أَرْسَلْتُ. And even it sounds in Arabic closer to the word أرسلت, Rasul أرسلت. But the Prophet ﷺ, upon hearing Al-Bara, repeating the dua, with changing just one word from Nabi to be Rasul, he poked in his belly, his stomach. He said to him, قُلْ لَا say. He said to him, no, not this. Say, وَبِنَبِيِّكَ الَّذِي أَرْسَلْ. And I believe in the Prophet that you have sent. No, not much difference. But it's important to stick to the words of the Prophet ﷺ. That is why we find so many people, they change the words. And they think when they add up things to their prayer, or they add up things to the dua, they make him a better dua. It is not true. It's absolutely not right. So we're going to discuss that inshallah after the break. Jazakumullahu khairan. And hold on. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillah wa salatu wa salamu ala Rasulillah. Welcome back after the break. And we are at the moment to talking about the dua that the person learns from the Prophet ﷺ. He needs to stick to it. He cannot add words. And I said there are some examples of some people, even some imams of some masajid, when they do the dua, they add things. Like for example, from the words that the people add in their prayer, when they say, Sami Allahu liman hamida, instead of saying, Rabbana lakal hamd, or Rabbana wa lakal hamd, they say, Rabbana lakal hamdu wa shukur. You should not do so. Even though alhamd and ashukur, there's not much difference between them. But remember what the Prophet of Allah said to Al-Bara. No, say, وَبِنَبِيِّكَ الَّذِي أَرْسَلْتُ. That's how I taught you. Same thing with some of the imams when they, for example, unfortunately, when they do the dua of the qunut, if they do it, for example, in Ramadan, they start now adding things. اللهم اهدنا في من هديت وعافنا في من عافيت. It's اللهم اهدني في من هديت وعافني في من عافيت وتولني في من توليت وبارك لي فيما أعطيت وقني شر ما قضيت. They say, وقنا شر ما وصرف عنا وقنا شر ما قضيت وصرف عنا ما قضيت. They add وصرف. Where is it coming from? إنك تقضي بالحق ولا يقضى عليك. The words is supposed to be إنك تقضي ولا يقضى عليك. They add the word بالحق. Where is it coming from? Stick to the words of the Prophet ﷺ. Now coming to what Sa'id ibn Jubayr now, he said to him. He said, verily, you've done well, but I've heard something else. I've heard from Abdullah ibn Abbas that the Messenger of Allah is talking about an incident that took place for him. That is, he was made to have the nations passing in front of him. Nations passing in front of him. Now, was that incident during the Isra, or was it during the vision? Now, there's a difference among the scholars. As for the narration during the Isra, is not authentic. It's in Sunan al-Tirmidhi. But the narration which is authentic, that is, it actually is a vision that the Prophet of Allah had seen where the nations were made to pass in front of him. So he said, عُرِضَتْ عَلَيَّ الْأُمَمْ. He had seen the nations passing in front of him. He had seen a prophet followed by 3 to 9, الرَّحْت وَالرُّحَيْت. And he had seen a prophet followed by 1 or 2. And he had seen a prophet followed by none. And what do we learn from this? We learn a lot. SubhanAllah. We've seen a prophet followed by 3 to 9. A prophet followed by 2. Prophet followed by no one. As a da'iyah, this is alhamdulillah something to boost your mashallah da'wah. You're not concerned about how many people they follow you. How many people they listen to you. Alhamdulillah, you do your job. Now this is a prophet who's been strengthened with the prophethood, who's been given super qualities, yet he preaches to the people and the people, they don't respond. He preaches all his life, 950 years plus, where the Prophet Nuh alayhi salam was calling the people to Tawheed. Very few people responded. Very few people responded. SubhanAllah. The whole life of Nuh alayhi salam. So if a person, for example, was preaching to the people, talking to them, and only very few people listen to him, even though that he's the true scholar, the true da'iyah, nevertheless, alhamdulillah. Look at the prophets. 1 or 2 following him, and even no one followed him. So if you find, for example, unfortunately, that the people that are only listeners to those people who are, I call them pop stars, rather than to be da'iyah, pop stars. Okay? So not every person, for example, you see that he gives a nice talk, he's a scholar. Unfortunately, now at the moment, the people, they can't distinguish between a scholar and a non-scholar. Between a student of knowledge and somebody who is not a student of knowledge. Person who is saying haq and somebody saying batl. You have to be sincere to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for seeking the haq. So, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He tells us regarding the people, وَمَا أَكْثَرُ النَّاسِ وَلَوْ حَرَصْتَ بِمُؤْمِنِينَ O Prophet of Allah, even though that you are keen, you are desiring for people to be believers, most of them, they're not believers. Most of them will not believe. وَمَا أَكْثَرُ النَّاسِ وَلَوْ حَرَصْتَ بِمُؤْمِنِينَ And that is why the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, بَدَى الْإِسْلَامُ غَرِيبًا وَسَيَعُودُ غَرِيبًا كَمَا بَدَى Islam started as little. Very few people had embraced Islam. وَسَيَعُودُ غَرِيبًا كَمَا بَدَى And it will return as a stranger, just like it was started. People now these days, when they implement their religion, they find themselves, it's very hard to act upon it. It's like you're holding to a burning coal. So never ever think that if the person has got so many followers, is upon a haqq. This is not a criterion by which you could distinguish a da'iyah from a da'iyah. MashaAllah, he's got millions of people listening to him. That's not right. Or you can't say a person who's got very few people listening to him, he must be wrong. That's why few people listen to him. That's not right. Ibrahim alayhi salam is a prophet, but he was on his own, on the haqq. But Allah describes him, kana ummatan qanita. He was nation, on his own. Kana ummatan qanita. And he was a devoted worshipper to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he was Ibrahim alayhi salam in his own. So never be deceived that, oh, this da'iyah, he must be right. This scholar must be right because we have so many people listening to him. That's not true. This is not the criterion by which we distinguish the haq from the batil. Now coming back to our story. So he says, Ra'aytu an-nabi, I have seen a prophet, 3 to 9 people, prophet with 2 people, prophet with as well, no one following him. Now the Prophet ﷺ tells us that most of the people will go to the hellfire. And that is why he narrates for us a hadith when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells Adam alayhi salam, Ya Adam. So Adam responds, Labbayka wa sa'dayk wal khayru bi yadayk. At your service, at your command, O Lord, and all the good is in your hands. He said, Akhrij ba'th al-nar. Allah commands him to bring the ba'th al-nar, those who will be entering the fire. He said, وَمَا بَعْثُ النَّارِ And who are these people who will enter the fire? He said, from your offsprings, from every 1,999. From every 1,000 from your offspring, 999 will go to the fire. And except for one will have salvation. And this is the moment when the child will grow gray hair. This is the moment when the pregnant woman will drop her load. This is the moment when you find the person is like a drunk, but he's not drunk. He's swaying from one side to another. Then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said and continued. So the companions themselves, they were wondering, who is that man? Messenger of Allah, who's that man who's going to be saved? So he said, Abshir, have a glad tiding. Ya'juj wa Ma'juj. Those two tribes that will come at the end of the time, that whenever they are there, they will make the whole ummah, you know, great number. So those people, he said, 999. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will take 1,000 from them and put them in the hellfire. So don't worry. So it's not going to be from you. It's going to be from the people of Ya'juj and Ma'juj. And then he said, وَالَّذِي نَفْسِي بِيَدِهِ Inshallah, by the one in whose hand is my soul, that I hope that you will be a third of paradise. قال, they said, Allahu Akbar, Alhamdulillah, the companions. And then also he said, maybe half of the Jannah, half of paradise. Alhamdulillah. Not only that, even he had said better than this. Prophet ﷺ, he told us that the paradise is 120 rows. 80 rows is from the ummah of the Prophet of Allah. That means 2/3 of the Jannah will be from the followers of the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Mathalukum, that is the similarity of yours, like the similarity of between you, the whole nation, the other nations, like the similarity of a white hair, white single hair in an ox which is having a black skin. Imagine a skin of an ox, got all of it black and one of it is a single white hair. It's just like the similarity of us, the Muslims, compared to the other nations. Now, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he was made to look and he saw a horizon. And those, he said, those are the followers of Musa alayhi salam. He thought it was his followers. And they also, oh, too many. And I'll tell you that the greatest of all followers after the followers of the Prophet of Allah Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, are the followers of Musa alayhi salam from Bani Israel. And he said, no, they're not their followers. Look at the horizon and the other horizon. two greater groups than the first group that he had seen, a group following Musa alayhi salam. He said, this is your ummah. MashaAllah, great ummah. And among them there are distinguished people as well. Those distinguished people, 70,000. 70,000. What's so special about them? Will enter paradise without reckoning and without punishment. Not just without punishment, even without reckoning. Straight away to paradise. So now, 70,000, it's not really that much compared from the time that the Prophet ﷺ started his da'wah until today. But we do have an increase on that number. We have a hadith from Thawban. Thawban happens to be the free slave of the Prophet ﷺ. He was a servant of the Messenger of Allah. Thawban, he said, verily, the Prophet ﷺ, he said, 70,000 from my ummah will enter paradise without reckoning, without punishment. With every thousand, there is another 70,000. And not only that, وَثَلَاثُ حَثَيَاتٍ, and three throws from Allah the Almighty. We don't know how many people in those throws. So don't worry, there's a place for you. But there are conditions. You need to do something before you get into those 70,000 people will enter paradise without reckoning and without punishment. So we're going to discuss, inshallah, what are the conditions for a person to be amongst those 70,000. We're not be able to do this in this episode, because it's a great issue to do, to talk about it. But we will tell you that regarding those 70,000, it's not really a hard thing to do. Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, verily those are الَّذِينَ لَا يَرْقُونَ وَلَا يَسْتَرْقُونَ وَلَا يَكْتَوُونَ وَعَلَى رَبِّهِمْ يَتَوَكَّلُونَ. There's another ration which says that they do not make ruqyah and do not seek ruqyah, and they do not believe in omens, and they put their trust solely in Allah the Almighty. So here in this narration, say they don't make ruqyah. Now this narration, even is Sahih al-Bukhari, it is unauthentic. Sahih Imam Muslim is unauthentic. Just that word. The scholars had said, the word instead of la yarqoon is supposed to be la yastarqoon, la yaktaoon. So the ones who do not seek ruqyah, not to make ruqyah, seek ruqyah, and the ones who do not as well believe in omens, and the ones who do not cauterize, and they put their trust solely in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Why do we say that yarqoon is lafza shadha? It is the strange word. Because we know that the Prophet ﷺ, he himself made ruqya. He made the ruqya. He read the ruqya, the incantation on someone. Also we have Jibreel alayhi salam made the ruqya. We have number of companions made the ruqya. So making the ruqya will not take you out of the 70,000 who will enter paradise without reckoning, without punishment. And that is why we say that narration, not just to say it is being narrated from someone who is not as trustworthy as the person who narrated the word yatatayya, that is yaktawun, cauterize. It is actually the meaning wise, Prophet of Allah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he made ruqya. So we cannot say the person who makes ruqya will be exempted from it. So don't worry, you can make ruqya. But it's the only thing that we talk about, to seek ruqya. Now seeking ruqya is not prohibited, but it's something we say it is not the best to do. Seeking ruqya, it is not the best thing to do. InshaAllah, in the following episode, we will talk about the ruqya in details and the other conditions that will make you enter paradise without punishment, top of that, without reckoning. أسأل الله سبحانه وتعالى أن ينفعنا بما قد سمعنا وجزاكم الله خيرا. الله الله.